Okay, so welcome everybody to the last talk here at the first day of SOTM. And we will finish the day talking about QGIS. You heard two talks before that it's a great and famous desktop GIS that maybe a lot of you use already. And I would like to show you how you can use QGIS in combination with your OpenStreetMap data. I was not sure who will be here in the audience because it's my first SOTM. So who used QGIS already? Maybe hands up. Okay, maybe most of you used it already. So it's really great and famous. And maybe, yeah, you will find some new things in the talk, or maybe you know a lot of it already. So my name is Astrid Emde and I work at Ware Group in Bonn in my daily life, and I use, oh, that's the last slide, sorry. Go back. Where is it? Oops. Okay. Ah, I took this one. Okay, so that's better. So I'm from Ware Group in Bonn and from OSGEO, and we want to talk about QGIS, the most used open source desktop GIS, and I really love the software. I use it a lot, and I use a lot OpenStreetMap data because I'm lucky. I work at a company where I can use all these great software and open data, and I build web applications with PostGIS, PostgreSQL, Map Server, Geo Server, Map Proxy, OpenLayers, GDAL, and Map Bender, and more. Yeah, more, that's MOPS and Metador, that is software that is developed at Ware Group, and we have a QGIS help desk, and we have FOSS Academy courses where I teach people to learn about QGIS. So let's see where QGIS comes from. We say QGIS in Germany, or many people say maybe QGIS, so I try this now. It started in Alaska, it was 2002. That was a time when PostGIS was already alive and the first version was published, and there was this Gary Sherman. He needed a viewer for PostGIS data, and he developed QGIS as a viewer for PostgreSQL and PostGIS data, or better, PostGIS data. So it's a desktop GIS. A lot of development took place in the meantime, and it's very powerful desktop GIS with a lot of functionality and a great community, which is very passionate and is located all around the world. And QGIS is a lot of fun, but it's not only for a community project. People live on QGIS and develop for the project, and so it's business as well. 3 weeks ago at FOSS4G, there was Andreas Neumann. You see here on the picture, he's in the PSC of QGIS. He's from Switzerland, and he talked about the state of QGIS. And you see here some notes that he mentioned. So 2002, I mentioned already, the popular open source desktop GIS I mentioned already. It's the second most popular GIS after S3 ArcGIS. It's translated in many, many languages, 48 languages, maybe nowadays more. It's platform independent, so you can use it on Linux, Windows, Mac OS, and Android. We have four, or I say we, I'm more a user, but not a developer, a contributor. There are four releases. It's released every 4 months with a long-term release every year. And you have an amazing cartography toolkit with Atlas and report generation. It's a powerful analysis and modular building platform with processing. You have mobile data collection solutions for Android and Windows with QField and QGIS Room, and a platform for developers to build custom solutions. And it's also an OGC server with ease of use for styling, labeling, and printing data. So when you go to web, you have clients already associated to QGIS. So it's QWC2 web client, ListMap, and GISQuick, and more. So there are a lot of, it's a big ecosystem developed around QGIS. And here you see the last versions. So at the moment, the long-term release is version 3.4. There was a big break from version 2 to 3. And there was, for example, Python 3 implemented in QGIS. So you should go now to the new world with QGIS 3.4. And the actual version is Zanzibar. It's QGIS 3.8 at the moment. So you see all these names connected to the versions that are names where developer sprints took place. So you see that's a very active community. So every 4 months, they need a new name for release. So it means they have to make community sprints. And they do it. And this is a picture from Fosfuji in Bucharest, where they met before the event. And we're working on QGIS. And that is how it could look like. So what does it offer? So QGIS is a desktop GIS, and you can load all sorts of data to your desktop GIS. Vector data we separate, and raster data, and maybe a lot of services like WMS, WFS, WMTS. You can do a lot of things with these data. You can view them and create them, process them, print them. You can style them. You can set up routing functionality on them. You can create services with QGIS server. And you can go out in the field and use QField, for example, to create to use data outside and create and collect data in the field, and much more, because it's so much around QGIS which grew. So if you want to use QGIS and open source, it's easy to visualize your OpenStreetMap data and to work with OpenStreetMap data with QGIS. There are a lot of plugins around in QGIS to use OpenStreetMap data. So for example, you could go to GeoFabric and go to the website and download, in this case, PBF files or S3 shape files, that's what they offer. And then you have to think about that you have different data models. In OpenStreetMap world, we have nodes and ways and relations and tags. But if you go to the desktop GIS, we handle points and lines and areas, and they have attributes. So somehow a transformation has to take place. And for this, it is GDEL which comes into action, which is a great library, GDEL OGR it's called, and GDEL is for raster data and OGR for vector data. And it supports OpenStreetMap data, so this will process the data and enable it to be loaded in the desktop QGIS. So it's easy to load OpenStreetMap data. You can drag and drop your data to use this in a QGIS project. You can choose a geometry type that you are interested in. There will be temporary layers created. Then you can transfer the data maybe to other data formats like geo package or into a database, into a PostgreSQL PostGIS database with a DB manager. And then you can style your data as you like. Here, I downloaded the data from this region. It's Regierungsbezirk Karlsruhe, where we are. So here you can see I can easily drag and drop the data to the viewer. And if you have a look at the slides later, you can see you can drag it here and the data is processed, and you can, one by one, you can track the data to your QGIS project. But these are already only temporary data, so if you want to use them for a longer time, you should save them in a different format. This was the loading of shape files. But if you download a PBF file, you can drag and drop it to your project as well. And then you will see that there are the different types that are offered to you. So whether you want to load lines or points or polygons, and you can load them all, or you could choose which data format you would like. And if you do that, it's a long process. It depends on the amount of data, how long it will take to load them. So you should transfer them to a different format as well. Okay. So if you have a look at the plugins from QGIS, you have at the moment more than 500 plugins available in the QGIS projects. It took a while till the, it takes a while till the programs get transferred from the 2 version to the 3 version, so maybe some plugins which have been in the old version are not there yet. And if you filter them concerning OpenStreetMap, you get a list of maybe some interesting plugins available. And I will go through some of the plugins to show you what you can get. So you have Quick Map Services plugin, where you can choose from different base maps, different services that are available, and you could load the services to your project to have nice base maps and background information. And here you can see you have a lot of OpenStreetMap data, available services available, OpenStreetMap standard, topology, hiking maps, or you have Bing data and a lot of more data. So it's really easy to load them, and I skip this video. So then you have the plugin Quick OpenOSM. We saw that we can download the whole data and then load the data for a special region to your project, but you can also do it with Quick OSM, which is much better, I think, because here you can choose which data you are interested in and maybe which region you are interested in, and it will communicate with the overpass RP and only loads the data that you are interested to your project. So, let's see. Oops. Okay, and here you can see you can download, for example, the shops and only the bakeries from Heidelberg. You could run the query, then the data is processed from the overpass API and will be loaded to your program. Or you can go to the query and change the query. And maybe, let's see. I know that was too late. Okay, so you can load data, and you see it has an autocomplete, so you can see which tags are available. And now here you can see the query that is generated to run to the overpass API. And then the data is available already in your project. It's only temporary data, so if you want to use them for a longer time, you should export them. In this case, maybe to GeoPackage. Let's see what else. You could query your data and see which information came from these queries with all the tags that are generated to the new structure as attributes now in your layer. And you can easily style your data. In this case, I would like to show the bakeries as Brezel maybe in my map, so I choose make them a bit bigger. I choose a nice SVG symbol, this Brezel, and then let's see how it would look like. Maybe I have to change the color because red is not so nice for Brezel, and then I have my map and I can show the bakeries quite easily. Okay, so let's see what else we have. We have a plugin OSM downloader. You can define a rectangle, maybe, that you are interested in, and load the data from a given area. And that's all about the downloads that I would like to present. Now let's have a look at the locator filter. So you can communicate with a nominatum geocoder to search for locations. And there is this nominatum locator filter plugin that you can activate. And then you have here the locator bar that is new in OpenStreetMap 3, where you have all sorts of nice features that you can access from here in a quick search. And there will be, oh, let's see. Okay, let's see here. So you have this new OSM when you activate the plugin, and then you can type your search here. You need a space, and to type a space, and then it will be sent to the nominatum geocoder, and easily you can choose from the suggestions which location you would like to go. Okay, so there's another plugin. It's called OpenStreetMap Place Search. It also uses a geocoder nominatum, and you can find data as well. You can set a filter via the configuration. You can load the result in your project, also possible as mask, as you can see here. And you can do reverse geocoding. There's a button here where you can say, okay, let's see. And ask the plugin, where am I? And then it will suggest the location that you are. Let's see. So I type Mannheim. That's maybe the place where most of you came around to get here to Heidelberg. So now I see Mannheim. I can add this feature to my project. I have to define the projection to add it. And then it will appear in my layer tree. If I go now to Heidelberg, I find a lot of suggestions for Heidelberg. Maybe some are not in Germany, so maybe I could limit the search to the extent that I am already in. That would be here. Or in the configuration of the plugin, so I could limit it here. Let's see. Or in the configuration, I could go there and should say, could define filters. So maybe I can say, okay, I'm only interested in results of Germany. So I could define the filter here and then only search in Germany or in a special extent. So now I find Heidelberg and could use a mask feature to add this data to my project again. And here it is, and then I can style it, maybe change the opacity and create a nice map. And here's a geocoder where I can do a reverse geocoding and find out that I'm in Heidelberg at the moment. So we have plugins about concerning routing. So there's an ORS tool for routing. It offers the functions of open route services based on OpenStreetMap. So I can use them in the desktop GIS here as well. So I could define a start point and a target point and then get an interactive routing on the map. I can calculate isochrones and matrix calculations. I can process framework, can handle point files. That's masks that you can see here, where you can upload point files, and I can output the data. I get new layers that are added to my project, which will include duration, length, and start and end location. So that's useful as well. I have a nice plugin. It's Animate OSM, which may be very interesting for the hot teams, and they use it when they work on tasks in the hot manager. They can see what happened in a special time frame. So maybe you have this hot tasks that should be solved. You can go to this location, download the data for a special time period. So you could define the start and the end date, and then you can process images for this time period and define which hours in which interval you should make a picture, and then you can see here in the Explorer that there are a lot of files generated, and from these files you can create a video and easily can see what happened in these regions and how this mapping event succeeded. And this is done by Raymond Neeson. He's quite active in the QGIS community, and he's, yeah, so I wanted to mention him. We have 3D functionality in core QGIS, which may be interesting for you. You can have online terrain, access to online terrain, and get buildings and image exports. Or you could load your OpenStreetMap data and define or choose the height of the buildings and to visualize them. And then you have this 3D viewer where you can make a journey in this 3D viewer with QGIS. Okay, so there might be a lot of more things that I didn't show you yet in this presentation, but I have some more slides to show you where you can find information. it's quite a lot of information around where you can get inspired. So the first address, which is quite good, it's qgis.org, where you get a visual changelog, for example, for every version. You get a good documentation and tutorials, and this is translated to several languages, so it can happen that you find information in your language as well. OSU Live is a nice starting point if you want. You have QGIS and QGIS server already installed, and you have quick start documentation where you can get the first steps with QGIS and work through these examples. And you have also OpenStreetMap software integrated on OSU Live if you want to use them as well. Then you have nice books. There are two books that were published in the last month. So we have QGIS Map Design from Anita Grasser and Christian Petersen. That's a quite nice book. It's a second edition, which was published now focusing on the version 3. It was there before, focusing on version 2. And there is a good book from Kurt Menke, Discover QGIS 3EX, and they're both published at Locate Press, which is the company run by Gary Sherman, who created QGIS. We have a lot of blogs and tweets around, so when you are on Twitter, you find a lot of QGIS information there. Also, Anita is tweeting a lot, and there's a company, I think in New Zealand, North Road, they do a nice thing. It's an advanced calendar. So every day you get a nice example how you can use QGIS, and you have a lot of videos around. Every conference that we run, for example, last Phosphogy conference, there have been a lot of QGIS talks around. So you will find them either on TIBAV portal when you search for QGIS, they have more than 400 hits, or maybe you find some QGIS talks on Media CCC, that is a team that does the recording here for this conference as well. And in the OpenStreetMap Wiki, you find information as well about QGIS, and that's what I wanted to show you about the project.
Thank you, Astrid. Does anyone have questions?
Hi. You talked about importing OpenStreetMap into QGIS, and you said PBF. Is it natively import? Do you hear me? You said about importing PBF files into QGIS. Is it now natively or what? Before. I still use GIA package as a middle step.
So it's GDAL, which does the work. Oh, the question was whether it's native in QGIS. Is
Can I drag and drop PBF directly into QGIS?
Yes, and it's GDAL which will do the work. GDAL, this library that I introduced, and there's this support for OpenStreetMap files. So it will do the work, and then the data will be temporary in QGIS. You can't edit the data, but you can, go from there to other formats if you want.
Okay, I know about GDAL because I'm using it to create the GIA package, and then okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Another one.
Thanks. So, as a beginner, I have sometimes input some data from OpenStreetMap and just dumped in a ton of data, but I'm not a professional cartographer. Are there tools that you would suggest to make the data look good once you have it in QGIS?
Can you repeat? Sorry.
Yeah. Once you have the OSM data within QGIS, is there a tool or a style or something that you would suggest to use to make the data look good to begin with before I start adding my stuff on top?
Okay. So for the version before, for the question was about styling and whether it's an easy way to style it, yeah? Okay, so for version 2, there was an SLD already, so you can style your OpenStreetMap data with SLDs that you add to the layers. And I'm not sure whether they are around for a version 3. Maybe someone else knows about that. but that would be the easiest way to load the SLDs and assign it to the layer, and then woof, it would look nice already. But we could check whether it's there already. There was another question, I think, or is it? No, same thing, okay, whoa, good.
Another one? We still have time? Yeah?
So what do most people do with the output that they get out of QGIS? Does it get used as static images, or does it get used as active web parts in web pages, or does it get printed out in maps? What do most people do with the software? Yeah. Is it all of these?
Okay. So I can talk for my company. So we use a lot of OpenStreetMap data to publish them as WMS services and create nice maps with them. And a lot of our customers, they use them as base maps as a background, and some of them use them as their city maps, the city of Wolfsburg in Germany. They cooperate with OpenStreetMap community, and then they publish their data. I'm not sure whether they do it with QGIS server that I mentioned to create web services, or with Map Server, which is a great software as well. But maybe it depends on your focus. My background is WebGIS, so most of my customers go direction WebGIS, but a lot of them maybe use them in QGIS as well.
Last question.
Hi, my question is about the design aspects, because I've worked with QGIS and ArcGIS a lot in the past, and I really prefer QGIS until I start trying to edit the appearance of my map, specifically in the print composer. So I was wondering if there are any like plugins or workarounds that you or other people know of for like designing beautiful maps in QGIS, because it's definitely possible, but I'm just curious what your take on that is.
Mm-hmm. Honestly, I must say I don't have recommendations there. I'm not, it's not my focus, but someone else, yes?
No, thank you. So thank you, Astrid.